thank you very much in behalf of the State Department and all the people who worked on this conference. I want to express my appreciation for all of you for joining us for what I think will be not only a stimulating discussion, but one that is extremely important to not just this group, but to people around the world. And I also want to particularly thank our speakers today who are going to be contributing to this, and to all of you, because this will be, I think, a more participatory kind of conversation than the past. I particularly want to thank Andrew Witte, who has really been, I think, the inspiration behind this overall event, and who's personally and whose company has been very actively involved in this area. And he's been describing to me just briefly some of the very interesting new drugs that GlaxoSmithKline has been working on. I also want to thank my colleagues in the State Department who have been actively involved in getting this going, and USAID as well. And this is going to be, I think, an opportunity for a lot of parts of the State Department to be able to explain what they're doing. And John Castellani, who's a very old friend, who represents pharma, which has been doing a lot of work, and we've been having conversations on these issues and many others, one of which is protection of intellectual property and dealing with counterfeit drugs, which is another very important area for us and for him and for the pharmaceutical industry. And so we have tried to use our capabilities here at the State Department and USAID and working with the industry and working with NGOs to focus a great deal of attention on these important issues. And we've been developing a very close relationship, in particular with Peggy Hamburg and FDA, because they have such enormous talent there, and we can use our embassies and our outreach programs working with them to address a number of these very important issues, particularly the counterfeit drug issue, but a number of others as well. Our goal today is not to focus on any specific therapy or treatment for disease, as important as these are, but rather how it is that we can work together to ensure the development of drugs and vaccines and encourage innovation in areas where there are barriers to investment, or put another way, market failures, such as in the case of neglected diseases. And this is really one of the points we want to emphasize. Or diseases that, if not neglected, are not getting the kind of attention that they should get given the number of people they affect. I know the actual cost of the development of a new drug or vaccine is a debated figure, but having been on the board of a pharmaceutical company, I can assure you, and I know many of you know this even better than I, certainly Andrew does, that regardless of what the precise number is, it is very expensive. R&D for new medicines is costly. Product development is a lengthy process. And every new drug that starts from the bench and goes to the market is an expensive proposition and a huge investment for pharmaceutical companies. But also, it's not just an investment for pharmaceutical companies. The public has a great stake in the success of the ability of pharmaceutical companies to innovate and to move through the long, arduous process of approvals and INDs and phase one, phase two, phase three testing the product itself. So this is not an easy or quick process, but the stakes measured in terms of human lives are enormous. I think we could probably also agree that the return on investment for drugs like Alzheimer's or anti-obesity medicines, if they're successful, is probably going to be higher than that for anti-malarials or anti-TB drugs, just because for a number of reasons, one of which is if you cure the initial disease, you use the drug, whereas some of these things are endemic and are going to require you to take the drug for the rest of your life. So there are a number of reasons why different sets of returns will be applicable to different kinds of drugs for different kinds of diseases. Nevertheless, the need for new anti-malarials and anti-TB and other life-saving drugs including those for neglected diseases, are desperately needed, even more so with the growing prevalence of drug resistance. And we hear about this and see this all the time. So the growth of drug-resistant viruses and is an enormous problem, and other kinds of things like MRSA and diseases you hear about a lot. It's in some cases the challenge of medicine is to keep up with the growth of drug resistance in a number of areas. When you go back in history, I was reading about Paul Ehrlich, who was awarded the Nobel Prize in 1908 for what was then called the magic bullet to fight various diseases. He was a well-known immunologist. He shared the Nobel Prize with another individual, but he really was a pioneer in this area. A lot of work has been done since, but people like that have really sort of pioneered the notion of immunology and finding answers to very difficult diseases. Modern medicine has come very far over the course of that period. Unfortunately, though, we still don't have a one-size-fits-all magic bullet to incentivize innovation for neglected diseases. But there are ways in which the private sector, NGOs, governments, and the international organizations that are so interested in this, such as WHO, can work together to address market failures or areas where the market, pardon me, doesn't serve as effectively as it might to address certain kinds of diseases. I know that other speakers have some very interesting stories to share, so I will quickly touch on only two topics which I'm sure they will expand. How governments can promote innovation in general and specifically for global health. That's going to be one very important question that we're going to have to address, and particularly we at the State Department are focusing on, and leadership by the private sector and NGOs to help incentivize R&D for neglected tropical diseases is really a critically important part. So it's really the government working with NGOs and the private sector. So the two key areas that I will just address very briefly are, one, government policies that can help create an environment conducive to innovation. And this is not just in the area of global health, but it's a broad issue in general. This includes, of course, education and research and development funding, but also good governance, transparent regulatory policies, markets that are open and competitive, and policies that allow companies to succeed and sometimes, in fact, to fail. If countries do not get these policies right, if they do not have the right innovative environment, the right regulatory environment, even massive investments in education and R&D are unlikely to afford innovative gains. So the policy framework, the policy environment, is extremely important. One area that I touched on briefly, but I'll mention again because it's particularly relevant in this context, is strong IPR protection. This is vital because it fosters innovation by providing incentives for companies to invest in new products or services to get people to devote their time and effort to devote to new products and services. So it's important for entrepreneurs, important for scientists, it's important for innovators that there be strong IPR protection. The State Department is working both bilaterally and in multilateral fora, such as the World Health Organization and the Asia-Pacific Economic Cooperation Forum, which is known as APEC, which the United States is going to host this year, the summit this year in Honolulu. We're using these to promote a range of policies that promote innovation, and part of that is protecting intellectual property. Neglected diseases and the development of cost-effective interventions are two of the administration's top global health priorities. That's why the National Institute of Health is starting the National Center for Advancing Translational Sciences. The center is designated to build new bridges that link basic drug discovery research with therapeutic development and clinical care, particularly in high-need areas that attract little commercial interest, such as rare and neglected diseases, which, of course, is one of the themes we'll be discussing a little bit further on. This includes working with companies to develop novel approaches to IP to facilitate development later in the pipeline. The center would also provide incentives for greater sharing of scientific information. This is just one example of how the U.S. government is helping to push forward global health innovation. Many organizations and many companies are experimenting with different models. For example, UNITAID, UNITAID, has established a voluntary patent pool incentive for medicines, initially focusing on HIV medicines. Their goal has been to encourage patent holders to offer, under certain conditions, IP related to the pool. NIH has embraced this opportunity and contributed to the pool. The World Intellectual Property Organization, WIPO, is doing work on open innovation, which often takes the form of finding suitable partners, especially through the internet. These types of programs are a step in the right direction, but I want to stress that they have to be voluntary. There isn't one size fits all or an option for one size fits all to deal with these kinds of issues. We have to work on this, and we have to work, again, with governments, NGOs, and, of course, the private sector. Technology transfer from the public to the private sector leads me to my second point, and that is leadership by the private sector itself, as well as NGOs and academia, to help lower barriers to neglected diseases, research, and development. Take, for example, the Medicines for Malaria Venture, or what is known as MMV. MMV brokers and managers in the industry and academia research collaboration area are developing new types of anti-malarials. Collaborations have been formed between pharmaceutical companies such as GSK, Pfizer, and Genzyme, as well as universities such as Harvard and MIT. MMV has received funding and support from government agencies, including USAID, private foundations, international organizations, corporations, corporate foundations, and from private individuals as well. Funding for R&D is important, but I choose this example because in addition to funding, MMV fosters data sharing, IPR transfer, and a mechanism to exchange expertise in R&D and manufacturing between the collaborators who are engaged in this process. In effect, they are lowering barriers to innovation in a variety of ways. Later this afternoon, Andrew Witte is going to talk about GSK's initiatives to support and share their company's knowledge in IPR so that others can build upon their past efforts to develop new drugs. Again, this is an example of lowering barriers to innovation for global health. Before I pass the stage to Lois, I want to note that we have allocated a significant amount of time for questions from the audience, so prepare to ask questions and prepare to participate in this process because this is going to be one in which all of you are going to be engaged as well. So I'd like to hope that, and I expect this will be a very open dialogue, and I appreciate your attention. I appreciate the opportunity we have at the State Department to play a role in this. I keep thinking, you know, in the State Department, we do a lot of things internationally, and there's a lot of diplomacy all around the world. Secretary of State's in Egypt and Tunisia earlier today, and this is, of course, important and indeed essential for the interests of our country. But one of the other roles the State Department can play and should play is to deal with these kinds of issues where we can use our strength and our capabilities internationally and the talent we have all around the world and the talent we have in Washington to address an issue that is important to millions and millions of people. And they have the opportunity to work with companies like GlaxoSmithKline and others and with NGOs and with the private sector to advance something. If we can make progress in this, save lives, make a lot of people's lives better, we will have accomplished something very important, and we can feel at the end of the day, at the end of our tenure here in this department, very proud that we've done something to help people's lives, and that, I think, is a very good feeling. So I thank you very much for listening, and Lois, up to you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Undersecretary Hormats, for getting us off to such a thoughtful start. Welcome to each of you here to the State Department today for this important conversation. A particular welcome to the ambassadors from the important partner company countries that we work on in global health, and to our colleagues from the White House and across the government. This audience today has in it many individuals who have made an enormous contribution in global health. And today, as we talk about how we promote innovation in tackling the challenges that we remain, your questions in this dialogue will be important. In my introductory comments, I'd like to just say a few words about the Global Health Initiative and some of the innovations that we have underway before turning it over to my colleague, Amy Batson at USAID. The Global Health Initiative is about increasing the pace of innovation in combating the challenges that we face around the world. And it's about doing so in implementing across the whole of government, taking the strong programs that we have in different parts of government and creating and leverage and synergies by helping them work together. We do that simply because the challenges we face are great. Far too many mothers and children die each year from preventable challenges. And far too many lives are ravaged by tropical disease, HIV, AIDS, TB, and malaria. We approach these difficult challenges with ambitious goals. They're rooted in principles articulated by President Obama in his Presidential Policy Directive on Global Development, by the Secretary of State Hillary Clinton in the QDDR, and by the principles we've laid out in the Global Health Initiative. This guides what we see as a successful global health and development agenda. Our job in the Global Health Initiative is to be more efficient and effective at global health, to build upon our successes, to learn from our mistakes more quickly, to strengthen health systems and encourage our country partners to build on successes in the field. We firmly believe that we are identifying a set of ambitious targets that we can meet through new methods by working in a more integrated way across government and with partner countries. Let me just highlight some of the innovations that we have underway that give us such encouragement that we can move forward. First of all, I want to highlight the way that we have combined several interventions to combat guinea worm disease. CDC and its partners have combined four interventions working across a whole range to decrease disease from almost 1 million cases in 1989 to only 4,000 in 2009, a decrease of more than 99%. These four interventions include health education, applying larvicide to drinking water sources, implementing borehole wells, and the creation of personal water filter pipes that people can wear around their necks when necessary. As a result, guinea worm disease is now in line to be the first parasitic disease to be eradicated worldwide. Other innovations come from identifying what programs can have the biggest impact and placing new emphasis on these interventions and our partnerships. U.S. interventions and investment in the prevention of mother-to-child transmissions of HIV is one of these important innovative approaches. This approach protects whole families, it's high impact, and it's cost effective. Transmission of HIV is a significant cause of new infections in children worldwide, and PEPFAR, the groundbreaking bipartisan program to combat HIV and AIDS worldwide, is using the antiretroviral drugs to stop the transmission of HIV between mothers and children. This saves the life of mothers, protects newborn infants, and keeps families together by preventing orphanhood. With this approach, 25 to 40% of babies of HIV-positive mothers will be born without, without this approach, 25 to 40% of babies of HIV-positive mothers will be born infected. But with this approach, that number drops down to 5%. In fact, this approach has virtually eliminated mother-to-child transmission in certain countries. Sometimes innovation comes from asking the right questions. In a study conducted by CDC scientists and funded by USAID, we found that by asking a few more questions of patients who are HIV positive, we could more accurately diagnose patients with TB. Prior to the study, screening consisted of a single question about prolonged cough. That screening method missed almost two-thirds of TB cases. Through our research, we were able to identify additional questions that, if asked, caught 93% of TB cases, an increase of effectiveness by almost 300%. This study has now become part of WHO guidelines, and at no additional cost, we've been able to ensure that more HIV patients receive early life-saving treatment for TB. These innovations are impressive. They build upon each other to create stronger healthcare systems globally and more effective and efficiency delivery of global health. But we can't stop here. We must create greater momentum around these results so that we can capitalize on our progress to sustain it, or we risk losing precious gains. This conference today will explore how we can do this more effectively in the future, working across lines, working in public and private partnership to get things done more quickly and more readily. I want to thank the organizers of the conference here today and my fellow members on the podium here. I'm going to turn it over next to Amy Batson from USAID, who will be followed by my colleague at the State Department, John Margolis, the Acting Deputy Assistant Secretary for Science, Space, and Health, and then Mr. John Castellani from Pharma, the CEO of GlaxoSmithKline. Andrew Witte will follow him. The other way around. Okay, Mr. Witte and then Mr. Castellani. And then we're delighted to hear in closing from the Managing Director of the Global Network of Neglected Tropical Diseases at the Sabin Institute, Dr. Niraj Mistry. Then we'll turn it over to you for our important conversation. So get ready for that. Thank you, and Amy Batson.
Thank you, Lois. Our thanks to Undersecretary Hormats and the State Department for hosting this very important event, which highlights, I think, two of the defining characteristics that have made, that have underscored all of our successes in global health. And that's the openness and the willingness of this community to invest in innovations, and the recognition of the need for partners who bring different expertise and different capacity to the table. Partners from the public sector, private sector, civil society, academia, and all the different skills from the scientists and engineers to the financiers, medical professionals, and even the economists. Each have brought the value and contributions that have been absolutely critical to the successes we've been able to achieve in health to date. But it's these very same characteristics, innovation, and the recognition of the value of partnership, that is going to give us the breakthroughs that allow us to really take the next leap forward in global health. The breakthroughs that it will allow countries to leapfrog forward with better tools and approaches, the drugs, the vaccines, diagnostics, devices, and strategies. When we think about innovation, people often think first about the science, and that is indeed where it all begins. And we have to give note to the National Institutes of Health, to our U.S. universities, the private sector, and biotechs and foundations for this U.S. contribution to science. But in fact, innovation is all the way along the chain. From the gleam in a scientist's eyes, to getting a product to market, to ultimately ensuring it is accessed by the women, children, and families that need them the most. Tools like an effective and affordable newborn resuscitation devices that are now saving infants' lives in Bangladesh. Tools like vaccines. A vaccine is so powerful that I can take my daughter to our pediatrician in Bethesda, in their beautiful offices, with the state-of-the-art equipment, and ensure that she is protected against a disease like pneumococcal. A mother in Kenya can go to her community health facility and ensure her child has exactly the same protection, not because of the infrastructure or the facilities, but because of the power of that tool. So if we pause for a moment to think about what was the chain of innovations that allowed that mother in Kenya to ensure her daughter had the same protection as my daughter, it is, of course, first the scientific work of groups like the NIH, public-private partnerships, foundations, and industry. It's also the innovations in the production processes so that manufacturers can reliably produce millions of quality doses at an affordable price. It's the innovative financing that ensures that this product can reach the market and reach the woman. Think about the markets we're talking about, from the U.S. to a child in Malawi, where total public expenditures in Malawi are $17 per capita. And think about that challenges that creates for that government to introduce the vaccine, or for a manufacturer to be able to make the kind of millions and millions of dollars of investments to be able to serve that market. Innovations like the advanced market commitment that help take a little of the risk out of producing a product and take a risk for the government that product will be purchased and made available to them if they introduce it. Structures like tiered pricing and the work of leading public-private partnerships like Gavi ensure an affordable price so that the poorest don't have to wait decades for the amazing innovations that we take for granted often here in the United States. Innovations in how we use these products, the kind of creative health systems, delivery mechanisms, approaches that ensure we get maximum value out of that tool, that ensure that a health worker can reach the family in a rural community. These kind of innovative approaches have made it possible to eradicate smallpox, have put us on the verge of eradicating poliomyelitis, have taken major global killers like measles and allowed us to reduce their mortality, their death burden, by over 75% in the last 8 years. And the latest vaccines against pneumonia and diarrheal diseases have the potential to prevent 4 million deaths over the next 5 years. These vaccines also give us the hope for the future. Imagine a world where we have a vaccine that can prevent malaria or TB or HIV/AIDS. In the U.S., our public-private partnerships in neglected tropical diseases is another innovative partnership, one that's based on a shared commitment and a recognition of complementary expertise. The very generous donations from pharma, from GSK, as well as Pfizer, Merck Germany, and Johnson & Johnson, where these companies have provided billions of dollars worth of donations of products, and over $1.3 billion alone in the last 2 years to countries supported by USAID for integrated NTD control. This contribution has allowed us to leverage our U.S. investments, of $90 million over that same two-year period, to focus on assuring the delivery. Thanks to this partnership, we're making rapid progress towards elimination of lymphatic filariasis, blinding trachoma by 2020, and eliminating onco from the Americas by 2015. The possibilities of innovation in global health are breathtaking. Imagine a rapid point-of-care diagnostic that would allow us to know whether a person standing in front of us within 15 minutes, that person has MDR-TB, and to immediately start treatment, rather than what we have now of having to get a physical specimen, ship it up to a central laboratory, have it processed, have that diagnosis sent back down, and then try and find that person, and then try and start treatment. Imagine what our cell phone technologies are going to do, and e-health, and the frontier that opens with the flow of data and information to both the consumers, the families, the women, and to the medical professionals, the health staff that are having to go out to the community, and how this will empower them. We're on the verge of a revolution in global health, one that's driven by innovations and partnerships. As Undersecretary Hormats said, our challenge in the U.S. government is to ensure that we are fostering the right environment to promote these kind of innovations and partnerships, that we are helping to accelerate the progress all the way along that chain, from the early science to the product development to making sure it actually reaches those who need it the most, and that we're identifying and setting the challenges for the world's innovators to respond to. I'll close with an exciting step forward that occurred just last week. Secretary Clinton, Melinda Gates, and Administrator Shaw, together with the governments of Norway, Canada, and the World Bank, launched a grand challenge for development, saving lives at birth. This challenge focuses the attention on that critical period at birth when mothers and newborns are most at risk. But what's innovative here is it doesn't define the solution. This challenge didn't say, and this is how we will solve it. We have all the answers. This challenge put out the problem, didn't define the solution, and didn't predetermine who is going to solve it, who will come up with the right solutions. Instead, we are putting out this challenge in development for all of the world's innovators to think about, to come forward with creative ideas, and to come forward with the kind of integrated solutions across various types of expertises that will allow us to really crack this. Thank you.
Thank you, Lois. Thank you, Undersecretary Hormats, for pulling everybody together for this. And thank you, Amy, for that, especially that last example of the wonderful work that AID is doing in inspiring folks around the world with development challenges, taking a look at the big picture, something President Obama asked us all to do in his State of the Union speech, to look at the grand challenges in front of us. So it's a wonderful thing to be able to see that actually come to fruition. Thank you for that. The public health challenges confronting us today are complex due to our changing and globalized world. We face climate change, food insecurity, and an increasingly interconnected world with unprecedented travel and trade. These new factors, as well as familiar ones, such as poverty, conflict, and extreme weather events, are contributing to increases in new and re-emerging infectious diseases. Dengue, for example, has increased at a steady rate for more than 50 years, with an estimated 50 million infections and 20,000 deaths occurring worldwide every year. The 2009 H1N1 influenza pandemic is another example of how diseases do not respect borders and can spread rapidly from one country to another. One of the challenges we faced during the pandemic was a vaccine shortage. Current technologies are simply inadequate to produce enough vaccine to meet global demand. The pandemic highlighted the need for improved technologies and for access to new and existing technologies on the part of emerging economies. We look to science and technology community to engage in the research and come up with the innovations needed to develop new technologies and treatments. And in our interconnected world, science and technology is not only the work of top teams of scientists. Increasingly, it's the diplomatic community that is involved in paving the way for research to be conducted across borders and for information sharing. The State Department has made a priority of science and health diplomacy in order to promote the advancement of technologies and innovations to improve health systems internationally, especially in the developing world. Here in Washington and in our missions abroad, the State Department, alongside with other agencies, U.S. departments, and especially AID, engages bilaterally, multilaterally, and international diplomatic fora to promote U.S. global health priorities, projects, programs, and public-private partnerships worldwide. I want to highlight three examples of how the bureau that I work for, the Bureau of Oceans and International Environmental and Scientific Affairs, is promoting innovation in science, health, and diplomacy to advance global health. The first example that I want to describe is our work through international treaties such as the Montreal Protocol on substances that deplete the ozone layer. One of the main treatments for asthma and chronic obstructive pulmonary diseases uses metered dose inhalers, or MDIs. But for decades, metered dose inhalers used chlorofluorocarbons, or CFCs, as propellants. And as we know now, those are among the most powerful ozone-depleting substances. OES, my bureau, and other U.S. agencies worked in close cooperation with MDI manufacturers to persuade them to develop alternate aerosols using ozone-friendly propellants. And the companies stepped up to the plate by developing propellants that not only help those with difficulty breathing, but we're also safe for the environment. This demonstrates the potential for innovation that can arise from cooperation between government and industry. But MDIs were just one part of the success story behind the Montreal Protocol, a protocol which, by the way, OES and the State Department spent a lot of time and effort trying to negotiate, and actually successfully negotiating. Today, it is widely considered one of the most successful multilateral environmental agreements, phasing out almost 100 ozone-depleting chemicals and placing the ozone layer on the path to recovery by mid-century. To give you a sense of what this means in terms of health benefits, the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency has estimated that this will result in at least 22 million fewer cases of cataracts for Americans born between 1985 and 2100. And this is just the number of cataract cases avoided in the U.S. The global number is obviously much higher. But the story here is not just about the ozone layer. The Montreal Protocol is also the most successful climate treaty to date because many of the ozone-depleting chemicals it has phased out were powerful greenhouse gases. The innovation that made it possible to replace those gases resulted in climate benefits that are about five times larger than those achieved in the first commitment period of the Kyoto Protocol. Next example is geospatial technology, which offers another example of how innovation and science diplomacy can work together to improve health. Geospatial technology incorporates remote sensing, geographic information systems, or GIS, global positioning systems, GPS, and web-based mapping tools. Geospatial technologies show great promise in improving disease surveillance systems, visualization tools, and early warning systems. This will help us understand the link between natural environment and diseases with environmental triggers or vectors, such as asthma, cholera, malaria, and yellow fever, as well as communicable diseases, including AIDS, TB, and influenza. Better knowledge and understanding of diseases helps us develop and apply more effective policies and programs to reduce the exposure of human populations to disease. Today, epidemiological surveillance frequently uses geographic information systems. For example, the President's Emergency Plan for AIDS Relief, PEPFAR, employs a high-technology feature that provides geographically linked HIV-relevant data. PEPFAR has generated tools such as an online HIV atlas for East Africa, which have helped decision-makers understand the spatial and temporal patterns of HIV infection and have allowed program managers to target their limited resources for greater efficacy in combating HIVs. The third area identified is cookstoves. Public-private partnerships are an important tool to address today's global health challenges, and successful public-private partnerships are structured in a way that encourages flexibility, cooperation, and innovation. The State Department, and OES in particular, has played a key role in creating and sustaining numerous partnerships, including the recently forged Global Alliance for Clean Cookstoves. The World Health Organization considers smoke from open fires and rudimentary cookstoves to be one of the five most serious health risks in poor countries, a problem affecting billions of women and children in the developing world. For the first time, the Alliance will develop and lead a global strategy to achieve global scale progress. And with the cooperation of all major donors, cookstove businesses, nonprofit organizations, foundations, academic institutions, corporate leaders, governments, and UN agencies engage in this work. Working in partnership, the Alliance will overcome the barriers that impede the large-scale adoption of clean cookstoves in the developing world, with the goal of saving lives, empowering women, improving livelihoods, and combating climate change. The United States is proud to be a founding member of this effort. We have made a five-year, more than $50 million commitment that currently spans six federal agencies. Some of the early activities of the Alliance will include setting up international standards for cookstoves, designing and capitalizing innovative financing mechanisms, championing clean cooking technologies across the donor and development communities, field testing clean stoves and fuels, and conducting applied research to answer the field's most pressing questions. The Alliance has an interim milestone goal of 100 by 20, which calls for use of clean and efficient stoves and fuels in 100 million homes by the year 2020. This is a start towards a long-term vision of universal adoption of clean and efficient cooking methods. Although we face new and emerging health challenges in a rapidly changing world, the power of innovation through international science and technology cooperation is one of our strongest tools for addressing these challenges. Diplomacy is central to coordinating these efforts and building political momentum in support of innovation for global health. Cooperation between the United States and the private sector through public-private partnerships helps us leverage resources and increase access to the resources for those in most need. I hope this event will provide us with the opportunity to discuss successful areas of cooperation as well as potential areas for partnership in global health. Thank you.